Finance Committee of the Scottish Parliament. Can I please remind everyone present to turn off any mobile phones, tablets or other electronic devices. Before we begin, members may be aware that there will be a 2-minute silence at 11 a.m. for Remembrance Day. I therefore intend to suspend the meeting about 10:50 to allow any member who wishes to make their way to Garden Lobby to join the presiding officer in remembrance, and the committee will then reconvene shortly after 11 a.m. Our first item of business is to take evidence on the Private Housing Tenancies Bill's Financial Memorandum from the Scottish Government's Bill Team. I would therefore like to welcome to the meeting Barry Stalker, Helen Duncan and Charles Brown. And members have copies of the Financial Memorandum and all written evidence received, so we'll go straight to questions from the committee. And as is normally the case in the Finance Committee, I'll start with a few opening questions to kind of set the scene, so to speak, and then colleagues will delve deeper into the Financial Memorandum. One hopes. Okay, so where should we start? I'm sitting here with all this paper because there's so many questions I want to ask, and it's always tempting to ask all of them, but I'm not going to do that. But there are quite a few issues that have been raised.
Yes, what's happening
today? Sorry, I'm going to ask all of the questions today. No. Right, okay. Where should we start? Let's start with the first tier tribunals, because that seems to have caused a bit of upset among some of the people who have made submissions. In paragraph 49, you talk about the FTT and talk about a fee for applying to Scottish courts at £70, and whether there will be a fee associated with making an application will be determined by Scottish ministers as part of the work currently ongoing to develop FTT. And you know, again in 83 it's mentioned that the Scottish Government has yet to decide if there will be a fee for applying that. Now how can you possibly put together a financial memorandum without something as significant as that? Because I would have thought that, you know, given the deliberations on this bill, before you put together the FM, you'd at least have made a decision on not only whether legal aid will be made available and whether there'll be a fee, but also how much that's likely to impact and who it's likely to impact upon. So can you talk me through your thinking in that and how it relates to the best estimates that you're supposed to have when you put together a financial memorandum?
Thank you, convener. I'll kick off, and then I may also bring in my colleagues from other conservancies as well. I mean, you're right in that when you refer to paragraph 49, there's not been a decision made regarding the first tribunal in terms of fees yet. That's a matter which is a collective decision for ministers and is going to be taken forward as part of the operational detail as the new tribunal is implemented. Now, of course, the new tribunal is being implemented from the 2014 Tribunals Act, and the first chamber in the new tribunal is going to be the Housing and Property Chamber. So work is underway, other colleagues are leading on that, and basically what that will do is bring together the current private rented housing panel, home owners housing panel, into the new chamber for housing and property, along with a new jurisdiction for called the PRS Tribunal, as well as a letting agents tribunal. Now, those two last ones for the PRS and for letting agents come from the 2014 Housing Act. So there's several things that are coming together. Now, in terms of the costs that we have set out in the financial memorandum for this bill, what we've been able to do is to build on the work that was undertaken for the 2014 Housing Act, in particular the PRS Tribunal that I just mentioned. That was work that was undertaken to basically estimate what the cost would be of transferring tenant and landlord disputes from the courts to the new jurisdiction. Okay. And in that, most of those cases would relate to the current tenancy. Now, in the future, when the tribunal is up and running, and we'd estimate probably a year after the new chamber is up and running, we look to implement, subject to the will of Parliament, the new tenancy. So we've been able to look at the costs that have been set out for the tenancy part of the new housing tribunal. So that's given us something to work from. What we've done in the financial memorandum is we have assumed that there's no fee to be charged, but we've said that there may be a fee, and that's something which ministers will decide in the future. But we've worked from the premise that there won't be, and that is reflected in, for example, the estimates that we've made for the number of cases that might come to the tribunal from the new tenancy. Likewise, in terms of the question about legal aid, again, that's a matter for the broader tribunal, and what we would expect is that whatever the decision is taken there would be the case for the new tenancy, which is set out in this bill. But again, we've assumed in the financial memorandum what we know, which is that at present that we're assuming that it's not going to be illegally. But that's not to say that there won't be in the future. So the assumptions that we've made is what we know, which is we're assuming that there's no fee, though there could be a fee charge in future, but we're assuming there isn't. For the purposes of this financial memorandum, and also for the purposes of legal aid, we're assuming that there won't be, because that's the case at present, subject to those decisions to be taken by ministers.
That explanation, but you will appreciate this is a really important aspect of the bill. I mean, you know, for example, the Association of Rental Letting Agents say, and I quote, "We remain concerned about the cost of implications for landlords when regaining possession of their property through the FTT. Where tenants lodge any case to the FTT, we believe they should pay. This would remove any temptation for tenants to continue stalling proceedings with no financial costs or penalties to themselves." But Shelter say, you know, exactly the opposite, which is Shelter Scotland is strongly of the view that financial provision must be made for legal assistance at the tribunal through a mixture of both advice and representation. It's also the view of Shelter Scotland that there should be no fee for private tenants to access the tribunal. So it seems to me that this kind of prevarication, if you like, in terms of me taking a decision on this is not really pleasing anybody. Letting agents and landlords are a bit anxious that this could open the floodgates, you know, to a whole load of potential applications, you know, and delay adjudications, etc., and decisions. And then you've got Shelter who are obviously concerned that tenants may have to pay. So when are we likely to have a decision? Stage two before stage one?
Okay. There's a couple of aspects to that. The first one is that what was set out in this bill is obviously a bill to introduce a new tenancy, and the question that you're asking is about an important element, as you say, how the system will work with that new tenancy. So it is a kind of matter for other policy areas, which clearly we're linked into. On fees, my understanding is that ministers intend to consult in the new year on the question of fees, whether or not there should be a fee, and if so, what that fee should be. And if there is to be fees, then that would require secondary legislation, which of course would be scrutinised by Parliament.
Let's move on to something else, and others may want to look into that. In paragraph 25 of the financial memorandum, you say that, and I quote, "Only 14% of tenants reported ever having left a tenancy due to unreasonably high rent," and you put "ever" in italics. But, of course, the rent cap is a key aspect of the bill. But in paragraph 77, you say, "A possible negative impact of a rent increase cap is that it may deter investment in housing and reduce the supply of new rented housing or investment in improving the quality of existing housing due to the lower expected rental return." But then you go on to say, "An investor will be able to recoup these costs by setting a higher initial rent, since the rental increase cap will not apply to initial rents." So effectively, it's like, it seems to me almost that you're, you know, giving with one hand and taking away with the other. So what's the thinking behind that?
Okay, in a minute I'm going to ask, I think, one of my analytical colleagues to kind of explain a little bit around the question you asked about the ever at the start of the question. But if I may, I mean, there's quite a lot to unpack there, so I'll try and be as succinct as I can. So the bill's about a new tenancy. Because it's an open-ended tenancy, then we need to address the question of what happens with rents. The reason for that is that the bill, the bill's overall aim is to improve security of tenure for tenants balance of appropriate safeguards for landlords, lenders and investors. So if you're going to improve security of tenure, what you don't want is the potential for some unscrupulous landlords to hike the rent as a way of subverting the increased security that, that we're looking to provide for tenants. So so the reason why we have an adjudication process for tenants is basically to protect against that. We also provide for predictability on rents for tenants, and that means that a landlord can only increase the rent once every 12 months with 3 months' notice, and that should help tenants plan their finances. Now, both those measures were supported, strongly supported, in both the two public consultations that we ran for the bill. And I think I'd put them under the kind of category of these are the kind of things that would apply to the tenancy in general. Now, the third element on rents is convenient, as you say, the rent pressure zones or the caps that would apply for sitting tenants in hotspot areas. And what that part of the bill does is basically say that for a local authority where they're concerned that rents are increasing significantly in a local area and that that is having a detrimental effect on tenants and housing, that they're able to apply to Scottish ministers and then for Scottish ministers to determine whether or not a rent pressure zone should apply. And if they do designate a zone, they would be able to set a cap for sitting tenants with a minimum of CPI plus 1%. So in the main, in terms of what's in the bill, rents will be market-led. In fact, all rents in terms of what's in this bill that are set initially at the start of a tenancy will be market-led. But the rent pressure zones will have a cap for sitting tenants, which would be set by ministers. So that's kind of broadly what we've set out in rents. Now, there's an important question, convener, that you've raised there about investment. Clearly, housing supply is important for the Scottish Government, and that's one of our sort of key policy aims, is to attract more investment into the sector. So we've been very mindful of that, in particular thinking through our proposals on rent pressure zones. So what we did was that, having listened to stakeholders, in particular the investment community, what we wanted to do was to try and alleviate the uncertainty that they were telling us that they were finding with what we were proposing. So we've did what we can in the legislation to basically try and set the parameters of what that would be. And in particular, and this is based on the bill being published and the feedback that we've received since then, it seemed to be fairly comfortable with knowing that initial rents will continue to be market-led and that there is a minimum for the rent cap, because that enables investors to basically model what could be seen as, from their view, the worst-case scenario, should there be a rent cap applied. So that provides them with some degree of certainty. But overall, we would expect that the rent pressure zones to apply in limited circumstances, which would be dependent on local authorities identifying there to be a need, as I set out earlier. And in the main, rents would be market-led, with the two sort of policies around predictability and protection against unfair rent increases for all tenants.
Okay, so I'm just wondering how it'll work in this scenario. Say mortgage rates, which are at an historic low, go up 2%, and the landlord's got a £200,000 flat in Aberdeen. That'll immediately mean that the mortgage that he'll be paying on that flat will be £4,000 a year extra, or £333 a month extra in mortgage. What would be the implication then? Would he be able to put the rent up? Would the cap be lifted? I'm just wondering what the flexibility would be in the legislation for these kind of changes. And also, of course, and if, for example, mortgage rates fell, would that mean that the mortgage cap would be reduced, or what would be the impact in terms of, because I'm not really seeing what the impact of that, because obviously that's a major decision in terms of people, if they're going to, particularly in these areas where there's a chronic shortage of housing, if they're going to invest and and they're going to be presented with a cap, who knows what the mortgage rate's going to be like in 3, 5 or 10 years. So I'm looking to see how you address that issue.
Okay, we have thought of that, and it's because it's a good, very good point. So Section 34 of the bill basically gives ministers power to change the inflation index. So basically, what we're looking to do there is to be able to, depending on what's happening with inflation, we could basically change the index, which would be used for the setting of any cap. We're also able to, if basically repeal of rent pressures, and if it was felt that, for example, the zone had been for up to a period of 5 years, but midway through the conditions had changed to such an extent that it was no longer required. So if that was required, then there would be a facility in the legislation to basically appeal the zone if that was found to be necessary. What we've also done in the financial memorandum is we've done our best attempt to try and model what the potential impact would be on for landlords using the recent historical data for Aberdeen. And if it suits the committee, my colleague Helen, who's an economist, would be able to explain a little more about that, if that would be helpful.
Yes?
The figures that were presented in the financial memorandum are obviously based on historical figures to present our best estimate of what would have happened with those figures. They are collected for two-bedroom properties. They're indexed to inflation to present the prices in 2014 prices. And then the annual change was calculated to establish whether or not a rent cap of CPI plus one would have come into play in those years. And if the annual increase was above CPI plus one for that year, then the rent cap was applied. The rent was stated as what it would have been if the increase had been above CPI plus one. And the impact that would have had on the landlord's loss of profit has been stated and then averaged.
All right, okay. Sure, Liz will want to look into that in some further detail. I just want to touch on a couple of areas quickly so that colleagues can come in. The Scottish Property Federation have talked about the frequent reference to modest and negligible costs of this legislation, but they've talked about not being set out in the summary table or elsewhere in the memorandum, and they said these cumulative costs to a small or medium-sized company can become overwhelming. And I think the point that's actually made in the financial memorandum is that most of the landlords actually only have one or two properties. Is that not, was it 95% of them only have one or two properties?
Yeah, thereabouts, yeah.
Right, so do you not accept that these additional costs effectively would have a detrimental effect on people deciding whether or not to actually put a place up for rent?
Again, it's a good question. It's something that we have thought about. What's important from the government's position here is clearly what we want private landlords to continue to play the really important role that they play in providing housing supply. But we also need to make the changes that were set out, because the PRS is basically changed from where it was when the current tenancy was developed in the late 80s. In fact, it's changed quite a lot even since the late 1990s. So what we've said in the financial memorandum is that because we're looking to balance or provide the balance with the grounds for repossession, where a landlord will be able to still recover possession of their property in all reasonable circumstances, that shouldn't impact on basically their ability to invest in property. So, for example, if you're a private landlord and you're looking at it as an investment, then you know clearly it's important to be able to receive a rent. Clearly, it's important to be able to appreciate the capital value of your investment through the sale of it. Both of these things can be done. In the grounds, there's a ground for selling, which is a mandatory ground, and there's also grounds there to deal with, for example, should there be any rent arrears. So we feel that through the grounds that we've set out in the bill, we've been able to basically provide cover for landlords so that they're still able to basically use or to let out their property and to be able to recover the investment in that property in the same way or in a similar way, to what they can do at present.
And the last point that I want to make actually before opening up is the issue of students. There's been some concern raised about the 12-month tenancy and how it will impact on students who currently often in places like Edinburgh I have 9 and 10 month tenancies, which suits them because they don't have to pay for a full year when they're only here for 9 or 10 months, and it suits the landlords because they can then rent them out to tourists, etc. in the summer. What's your thinking on that, and are there any proposals to potentially change that?
Okay. So Minister's position on this is that what this new tenancy is doing is it's basically replacing the assured tenancy regime. So all those tenants who are currently covered by the assured tenancy regime would transfer across into the new regime. So what that means is that for students, if they're on the assured tenancy currently, they transfer into the new tenancy regime. Ministers are keen that that the new rights that we're providing through this new tenancy would apply to all tenants that transfer across. So on the specific point of students, that basically means that students should have the same rights under the new tenancy as all other tenants. And also, we're looking to have a more simplified, clearer tenancy than the one which exists at present, and therefore having something that's simple, straightforward, and basically works across all tenants, say, in the sector, is therefore attractive. Now, on the point about students in the financial memorandum, we do recognise that this will have some potential impact on landlords who let out in that market. And what we've said is that we recognise that, for example, that it will mean that they'll need to, you know, there's things they could do, such as engage. They probably engage well with the tenants already, but they can continue to engage with the tenants to ask them when they might be looking to leave. There's nothing in the legislation that that deliberately ties in tenants to a year tenancies. So basically, at the moment, if you're a student, you can let, and the landlord would probably have under a short assured tenancy a set date where the tenancy should end. And in most cases, the tenant will leave on that date, though not always. Under the new tenancy system, then it would be for the tenant to basically provide notice to the landlord that they were intending on leaving. In most cases, in the student market, these tenancies tend to be backed up by a guarantor as well. So if a student is looking to stay on, they'll be obviously continuing to pay the rent. If they're looking to leave at the end of term, as you say, because they might want to have to stay for 9 months, they'll still be able to hand in their notice so that they can leave at that time. If they stay on for another year, they can still do that. The key difference being that it's in the tenant's hands to decide when they're going to leave, unless, of course, the landlord uses one of the grounds. But there's not a ground at the moment, and we don't intend to have a ground specifically to bring a tenancy to an end because the tenant's a student.
Okay. I can ask a couple more supplementaries on that, but I'll let others in, John.
Seeing we're on students, that was one of the areas I was interested in, so we'll carry on with that just now. I mean, I do wonder if students should be treated the same way as other people. And I mean, there's policy issues in there which this committee is not looking at, but I think I would be concerned about the kind of knock-on costs. Because, you know, not to be derogatory towards younger people, but, a lot of students are not going to be thinking too much about, oh, I'd better give in my notice by a certain time. And from what I understand with landlords, round about Easter, they'd be heading towards the end of a student year. They'd be looking at people staying in a flat over the summer. They'd also be looking at students for the following year booking up. And, you know, I get the impression that that system works fairly well in some areas. And I just wonder that if that is disrupted, then there are going to be costs for the landlords, and these costs are going to be handed on to the students. Because if they don't give in their notice, the landlord can't advertise for the following year, can't bring somebody in over the summer. And the assumption then would be that the costs would actually go up for the likes of students.
Okay. Well, we'll start at the end of the question and we'll come back if I may. If a student doesn't hand in their notice, they'll still be paying the rent. They'll still be in the tenancy. I mean, as I said earlier on, the overall aim that ministers have set for the new tenancy is to increase security of tenure, provided balanced with appropriate safeguards for landlords, lenders and investors. And key to that is not including what's commonly known as no-fault grounds under the new tenancy, which is where a landlord can bring a tenancy to an end on a specified date. Instead, landlords would need to have a reason. The National Union students and other sort of student representative groups have seem fairly supportive of the principle that students should have the same rights under the new tenancy as other tenants. And I think if you come to the question about costs, if you look at what a landlord can do, I mean, you know, the legislation says that a tenant needs to give 8 months' notice if the tenancy has gone beyond 6 months. So they need to give, 8 weeks' notice. So as a minimum, a landlord would have 8 weeks' notice before the tenancy ended. But they probably would have more. If you're a student, you know, you probably have an idea fairly early on what you're expecting to do. For example, if you're a first-year student, perhaps you're staying in a private residence, private halls, not with a landlord as a university, as a university as a landlord, but you'll probably be thinking about moving somewhere else in the second year. That's what tends to happen. I think students probably do have a fair idea about what they're looking to do.
Students may have an idea. My suggestion was, though, that they don't bother telling the landlord, and that they get to the end of the June, they've forgotten to hand in the notice, and they just walk away.
Right, well, first of all, we talk in a financial memorandum about landlords having good engagement with their tenants. So, you know, if a student was forgetting, then a landlord could always ask, you know, what's your intentions? There's nothing to stop landlords from doing that. If a student walks away, I mentioned that most students have a guarantor, so landlords already protect themselves against the potential risk of the rent not being paid. And also in the bill we have grounds for a landlord to basically recover if rent is not paid. If they need to recover rent, they can also go to the court. So we're not expecting there to be a significant change in how tenants tend to work with the tenancies that they they're in.
Yeah, I mean, the wider problem, I suppose, that's part of is the fact that on the table in the financial memorandum, which is page 22, and the point's been made by a number of people who submitted evidence, is that the words negligible and modest appear several times, especially towards the bottom of the page. And I mean, costs and other, the third column, the final column, costs and other bodies, individuals and businesses, which I assume includes both the tenants and the landlords, who are kind of major players in all this. When we get to total costs, all it says is modest in both cases. Now, we as a committee have been unhappy with a whole range of bills that have come here without actually putting a figure on it. And I think in most cases, we'd rather have, you know, some kind of figure rather than this modest and negligible. I mean, can you tell us, couldn't you have put some kind of figure in there?
In a minute I'm going to ask my colleague Charles to basically go through how we got to there. But I think what I can say is that I completely appreciate your point about not being able to put a figure. I think the simple answer to that is, in a lot of, we've done, you know, extensive consultation with stakeholders. We've developed a brief. We've had two public consultations. We've talked to stakeholders and engaged with them on a regular basis. And not really anybody's been able to put sort of firm figures on the potential impact to the sector. So we can only kind of work with kind of what is available in terms of figures. So we felt that the best that we could do was to basically highlight in the financial memorandum the areas where it had been brought to our attention as where there might be potential kind of costs, and we've done that, but we've not always been able to provide that cost because often there's just not a cost available. In terms of the terms of modest, that I think what we're really meaning is we don't expect it to be that much, but I appreciate what you're saying, is we're not able to put a firm figure on it, but then I don't think anybody has really been able to do that. But Charles, is there anything you wanted to add into that?
I think with the figures we've set out on the table, we have tried in all cases to be evidence-based. So we've based the costs on existing tribunals which are operating, which we know the costs of, and also we try to use information provided by stakeholders to us to give us some indication. So in those two senses, we have tried to be evidence-based and not just to pick figures out of the air. Therefore, where we can't do that in that case, we've expressed the cost as a narrative, as a text, rather than affix a figure to it, which we couldn't be confident in the robustness of.
I'm afraid I just find the whole concept quite strange here, because we've got legislation. Presumably we've got legislation because there's a problem. And I thought one of the problems was that landlords were making excessive profits in some cases by raising the rent, and that's why we've got this possibility of rents being restricted. Now, even if we looked at that point on its own, the super profits, or whatever we call them, that the landlords were making, they're not going to make anymore. So presumably they lose out. And the tenants who were paying the super profits are going to gain. So at the very least, I would have expected these two groups to be affected. Or are we saying there's no evidence that there are super profits?
What we've done in the Financial Memorandum, for example, and we wouldn't necessarily say super profits, but what we have done is we've looked at, as an example, in the recent past, Aberdeen and Shire, and the table that my colleague Helen was talking to earlier on is one example of where we have looked to say, well, we know what the rents have been in that area. We know that they've been rising quite high, and we've been able to model potential caps for certain tenants would be in those areas. So I think that is an area where we have been able to provide some costs on what would be from the potential for rent pressure zones in an area. So, I mean, as Charles has said, we've taken an evidence-based approach. Where there's been evidence, we've used it, and where there's not, we've done the best we can with explanation and narrative.
Well, I'm sorry, I'm still struggling to understand all this. Could we assume, therefore, that the landlord in the end of the day is going to get the same amount of rent and the tenant's going to pay the same amount of rent because the initial rent will be increased in order that they're, because knowing that there will not be serious increases during the rental period? And, I mean, also the suggestion is that if there are restrictions on rent, first of all, it will drive some investors out of the market. It will then push up the rents in the medium term, although I assume that would bring in more landlords in the longer term. So if we're really saying that the total costs for other organisations is modest, it seems to me we're saying there's, in the long run, there's no financial impact on anyone in this.
Okay. In terms of the question about rents, so basically rents will be market-led, and I outlined there a little earlier what we've put in the bill. So even when a tenant believes a rent increase to be excessive, and they can basically seek adjudication on that, the test will be, is that rent for the property that the tenant's in comparable to another similar property in that area? Basically, is that the market rent? So the general principle that we've set out in the bill is that landlords will be able to charge market rents. They do now, and they will be under this new tenancy. As I've said earlier, the one exception would be where there may be a rent pressure zone designated, and we've set that out in the table at the end of the financial memorandum. On the point of investment, I mean, there's probably two areas of investment in the PRS. There's as the convener mentioned earlier, the smaller scale, sort of more individual landlords, or landlords that have a smaller portfolio, and there's many different sort of types. Those that are actively investing, those that have inherited the property, those that couldn't sell, etc. But they all tend to have a relatively small portfolio size. It tends to be existing stock that they buy, sometimes with a buy to little mortgage, sometimes not. The other side of investment is what we're looking to do, which is encourage more institutional investment into the sector. And that's part of the government's broader drive to basically increase overall housing supply. In terms of that second area, there has been, I mean, it's still in its early days, but there has been some investments announced in the lead up to the bill. So particularly in Edinburgh, where there's about 700 units in the Fountain Bridge area from two separate developments, which will be institutionally investment-led PRS stock. And also, I think LaSalle have recently bought Dundara-built development in Dyson Aberdeen for around 300 units as well. And again, that's full market PRS. There has been, as I'm sure the committee will have seen, in the press recently around the bill, commentary around what the potential impact or not of what we're setting out may be, to provide a balanced view, the Scottish Property Federation Chair John Hamilton, who wouldn't support a lot of what we're proposing in the bill, says the SPF firmly believes that the introduction of rent controls will not help the nascent and new source of homes to develop in Scotland. In fact, it may well stop it from going beyond a handful of schemes. However, alternatively, Mark Donnelly, Associate Director of Colliers International, who basically provide global real estate services, have said there is nothing in the bill which ought to stop institutional investors considering Scotland for PRS investment. So I think on the kind of point around investors, you know, it's suppose it's a matter of perspective. On the one hand, you know, we've got some stakeholders saying, well, look, investors are looking at this, and the kind of perhaps putting their investments on hold to see the way the wind blows, what the final outcome of the bill will be. And on the other hand, we've got stakeholders saying, well, actually, this isn't a problem, and nobody's telling us that it is a problem. So, and again, we've done what we can in the Financial Memorandum to reflect that.
Just one other point, if I may, a separate issue altogether. Glasgow City Council raised the point that when we talk about rent pressure zones, there could be a variety of housing within an area, and you know, some might be more pressurised than others, so there might be lots of student accommodation, but not so much in the way of family homes. How would that be taken account of? And would there be a cost to the council in kind of digging into all of that?
Okay. I mean, I suppose the answer to the first point is it would be for local authorities. So what we've got in the legislation is basically discretionary powers for local authority to apply to ministers. In terms of the kind of detail around that would need to be taken forward in secondary legislation. But the answer to that question would be, well, you know, it'd be for local authority to identify where a rent pressure zone is required, subject to the tests that were set out in the legislation around there being a detrimental impact on tenants and housing rents rising too much. So that would be something for local authority. But of course, you know, subject to the will of Parliament, the bill implementation would be working with local authorities who may be considering whether or not, may be considering whether they may be looking to make an application for rent pressure. So we would work with them to basically ensure that there was a process in place which worked.
Are you feeling indeed that would be a huge cost for local authorities to do that in a study?
In terms of the costs to local authorities, we of course work closely with local authorities, both at a strategic level and also through the bill. So, for example, both Alachlo and Cosla are on the Joint Housing Policy Delivery Group, and both were on the review group that considered the current tenancy regime and made the recommendation to ministers that there should be a new tenancy, which is where what was set in the bill started from. And they both replied to the two public consultations, and we've discussed this with them. And basically, up until the point of the Financial Memorandum, which of course sets out our best estimates on the cost on the bill in introduction, there wasn't really an issue raised around cost to them. So what we've got in the Financial Memorandum is what we think the cost to local authorities would be, which are mainly around rent pressure zones. But I'm aware from obviously reading the evidence that's been submitted to the committee that, having now had a chance to look at the bill in detail, there may be a couple of areas that they think there might be more costs that may accrue to them. On the point about Glasgow, I'm actually meeting with Glasgow later on this month to talk about the bill, and I'm sure that we'll be picking up with Glasgow then some of the issues or matters that they've raised in their evidence to the committee, which you know, obviously be more than happy to discuss with them.
Thank you very much.
So I want to take you back briefly to the question you answered from John on investment. He quoted two individuals, one of whom said that the bill would have no impact on whether they were deciding to invest in Scotland, and the other one who said it would. Is there anyone who's actually said to you that they're going to invest because of this bill? You know, we're only going to invest in Scotland, but you know, this bill looked great, we're going to invest as a result of it.
That's a good question. And clearly what the bill's looking to do is to support a broader work on the PRS to make it a more professional sector, one that's attractive to investors. I was actually in a meeting recently with Lowther Homes, who are the private rented sector sort of arm of the Wheatley Group. They're very supportive of the bill and what it looks to achieve. The current investors in the PRS, they've invested significantly recently and are looking to invest even more in the long term.
So you're saying the stability caused by the bill could actually encourage more people to come in and invest?
We believe so, yes.
Okay,
yes.
Thank you. Gavin, to be followed by Mark.
Good morning. The University of Edinburgh say in their submission it's absolutely vital that accommodation provided by universities or colleges that remains exempt from the proposed legislation. And are they exempt from the legislation?
Yes.
any university or college provided accommodation?
Yes, in the bill, under in the schedule one, I think, where we set out the exemptions, basically that's we've carried across what happens currently under the assured regime. So where a university or college is a landlord, then they will be exempt from the new tenancy, as indeed they are for the assured tenancy.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. Staying with students just now, I mean, the convener asked a number of interesting questions there. You've obviously consulted a bit, but I just wonder from the sense of the evidence we've got, do you not think there's a slight concern, though, that what could happen is instead of landlords offering nine-month lets, which seems to suit both parties, the market changes so that you can basically only get a 12-month let, and therefore students who don't want to be in Edinburgh, for example, for the summer, are then tied into a 12-month let. Is that not one potential consequence?
As the bill stands at present, then it's possible that the initial period that we've set out could be offered by a landlord as 12 months, and if tenants accept that initial period, then that would, in effect, tie a tenant in for 12 months and also restrict the grounds that a landlord can use to evict for that period as well. I suppose, in the financial memorandum, we do say that we recognise that certain parts of the PRS would need to adapt. Whether or not that would be something which, in actuality, would happen, it's possible, but I don't think it's necessarily certain. I suppose again that comes down to what we've got in the bill at present around the initial period that we've set out in the legislation.
Okay. But what are, I mean, on the ground, what are landlords who let to students saying to you? Are they saying to you, look, we'll find a way around this and we'll still try to keep similar arrangements and we'll just communicate better with our tenants? Or are they saying to you, look, in order to minimise risk from our point of view, we think we're going to move to 12-month lets? Because if that's what happens as a whole, then students won't be able to find a nine-month let. I mean, what are landlords saying to you as you consult?
Okay. Well, they're not saying to me, or they've not said to me, the 12-month let, so that the evidence to this committee is the first that I've seen of that. I mean, it's fair to say that from a landlord's perspective, including the Scottish Association of Landlords, they're not in favour of there being no-fault ground in the new tenancy. So they would prefer that there was. So in those terms, then landlords are saying that that what we've set in the bill is something which they would be less supportive of. Other stakeholders, not necessarily landlords, such as the National Union of Students, Shelter, and so on, support what we've set out. And I mentioned Lowther earlier on; they're a private landlord, and they do support what we've set out. But I think it's fair to say that in the main, the main representative groups in terms of landlords would be less supportive of what we've set out in terms of not having a no-fault ground. But our assessment is that we recognise that we need to get the balance right, and that's why it's important to have the grounds which we've said will cover all reasonable circumstances a landlord would need. So it's obviously important to get that right, and what we've set out in the financial memorandum is that we believe that landlords would be able to work, where they have to adapt, they'd be able to adapt and still be able to work with it, because fundamentally they'd still be able to sell the property, they'd still be able to manage the properties effectively, they'd still be able to take action if for example, there was an issue with rent arrears.
Moving on to another issue then, first-tier tribunals. Just for clarity, because you give a couple of different answers, and I'm just trying to work out which one is the official government position. In terms of fees being charged, you said you're working from the premise that fees won't be charged. Is that what ministers have asked? Is that the premise ministers have asked you to work from, or is that just a bill team decision?
As a bill team, what we're required to do is provide a financial memorandum that estimates the costs on the bill introduction. That's what we've done, and we've done it on the basis of what we know now. So there's been no decision made. So in terms of the analysis, correct me if I'm wrong here, Charles, in terms of the analysis, we've assumed that there won't be a fee. But we've also said in the financial memorandum that ministers have yet to decide on that, and there could be a fee. And if there is, a fee charge, then that's not something we've accounted for in the financial memorandum at present. The reason is we don't know at the moment if there will or will not be a fee charge. So we can only go with what we know.
No, again, I'm just trying to figure out which is the default position. I mean, have ministers said to you, work from the premise that fees won't be charged, or have they simply been silent on the matter in their discussions with you?
In terms of this analysis, they've been silent with us.
Yeah. Fine, and then, but they're saying they're going to consult in the new year.
They're going to consult in the year, as I said, earlier on.
Yeah. Okay, fine. And in terms of, is it the same answer in relation to legal aid then? Have ministers been silent to you on that issue?
Yes.
Okay, and will that form part of a consultation alongside the fees issue?
I can answer that point. Give me a second. So clearly it's not my policy area, but the position is that legal assistance is a broader policy matter for the implementation of the FTT. It's not included in the cost for this. This is a policy matter that is still under consideration. Tribunal procedures are designed to be accessible and understandable and do not generally require legal representation. This will be the court case in the new tribunal. We recognise that cases that will be handled by the tribunal, including those involving repossession, can be of a serious nature, and we are considering requirements for support for parties bringing a case as part of the detail of the operation of the tribunal. This could be through funding support for legal representation and or some form of lay representation. Funding support for legal representation in other tribunal jurisdictions is generally provided through assistance by way of representation or ABWAR, which is administered by the Scottish Legal Aid Board. If selected, this would be set in place by secondary legislation, which would be scrutinised by Parliament. And that's really all I can say on that.
Sure. Yeah. I can't ask you to make things up. But in terms of fees, the mm-hmm. position is clear in that there's going to be a consultation and ministers will take a decision. Mm-hmm. In terms of legal aid, you don't have any further particulars on whether there is a consultation.
I've said all I can.
Sure.
I can
see that. Okay, no, fair enough. And just lastly then, again, it comes back to something that the convener asked. He asked about what happens if there are changes to mortgage rates, because mm-hmm. I guess most of us have now become accustomed to interest rate. We think interest rates of half percent are normal, and clearly that won't always be the case. You're saying in terms of Section 34, ministers will be able to make changes under regulations, but is there anything in the legislation that forces ministers to act? Because let's say a rate increase is announced by the MPC, let's say it happens immediately, and banks and mortgage providers, within days or weeks, change those mortgage rates. Is there anything in the legislation which compels ministers to review the situation quickly, or is it something that could just, lay dormant potentially for months or years before any changes are made?
In terms of the policy position, then yes, ministers should be able to vary the cap and rent pressure zone, for example, because of the scenario that you mentioned. When making a determination on the rent pressure zone, they are placed under duty to consult tenants and landlords before making a decision. So part of that is to provide a kind of safeguard to basically feed in the potential for that happening. But there's nothing in the bill at present which would basically make ministers have to change the cap because of a change in the interest rates.
All right, fine. I'll leave it there, convener.
We're going to have a break in a couple of seconds, but just and I'll let Mark and Jackie come in after we have the break. But what I'm this student thing I'm finding a bit confusing. I mean, at the moment you get 9 or 10 months, okay, let, and then 2 or 3 months the landlord will let his or her property out over the summer. Okay, so everything under the new legislation goes well, and they communicate brilliantly, and the student agrees to leave after 9 or 10 months. But then if the landlord decides to let the property out for 2 or 3 months in the summer, well, they have to then have a 12-month lease, even though they might only want to have 2 or 3 months let in the summer before they start the student letting again in the autumn. What would happen over that kind of intervening summer period?
Well, in the scenario you're outlining, normally what landlords would do would be to have a holiday let, so which would not be subject to this legislation because it's not someone's principal home, etc. If a landlord has a student let, they look to let it out over the summer, then they'd still be able to do that subject to the tenant moving out, and then if they want to elect a student again for the next term, they'll be able to do that, but it would be on the new tenancy.
Thanks very much. I understand Tanner is about to go any second. Here we are. So I'll now call a halt to proceedings, and we'll recommence shortly after 11, about 5:10 past. Thanks, everyone. Okay, folks, I will now reconvene the session. Mark to be followed by Jackie.
Thank you very much, convener. I just wanted to touch on a couple of issues. The first was a note, obviously, as an Aberdeen member, I was interested by the fact that you'd selected the North East Council areas as comparators. I just wondered, in terms of the use of CPI versus RPI, what dictated that approach? Because I know, for example, at a local authority level, when the local authorities are setting their rent, certainly in Aberdeen, we use RPI as the inflationary indicator. I just wondered why you'd opted for CPI.
Okay. excuse me. As a couple of reasons, I might actually also ask my colleague Helen to come in as well in a minute. One of them is that in other countries where they tend to have some form of rent cap, then it tends to be something equivalent to CPI. In terms of stakeholders, then there were stakeholders, I think, including Shelter, who, as part of the consultation, had said that CPI would be an appropriate inflationary measure. And as far as I understand it, I think it's also the measure that some housing associations use as well. So it's something which, as an inflationary index, tends to get used in the housing context, as I understand it. In the housing association world. Helen, is there anything you wanted to chip in on that or not?
Not in particular. Those are the main reasons. And as you said, it's the standard measure that we would use in the Scottish Government when we were talking about housing. So that would be why it was used in that case.
Just wondered. In terms of the impacts, I note the submission we've had from the Association of Residential Letting Agents, or ARLA, where they speak of the difficulties this could pose to independent agencies, also your individual letting agent, as opposed to your larger organisations and agencies, which could lead to, they say, some being either forced out of business or selling up their interests because of the costs that may be incurred. What would your response be to those concerns?
Okay, obviously we noted the concerns in the written evidence with keen interest. I mean, clearly, we don't want to be in the business of putting any business out of business. If you look at some of the other evidence that was provided to the committee, for example, the Council of Letting Agents, I think that they didn't raise similar concerns to ALA. And indeed, CLA, Scottish Association of Landlords, and Shelter, they'd probably be the three main tenant, letting agent, and landlord representative bodies in Scotland. And they seemed to suggest that the methods that we used to calculate the figures in the FMs appeared to be fairly sort of sound. So, I was interested in ours figures. It did seem kind of fairly high. When they mentioned compliance costs for large firms of in the hundreds of thousands of pounds, we know that sort of the larger letting agents' turnover would in Scotland would probably be somewhere in the region of £3 to £4 million. So, the figures seemed a wee bit high, certainly higher than what we've estimated in the financial memorandum. We take the point that clearly what we're looking to do in the bill is implement a change in the tenancy regime, and that will have some impact on letting agents. Now, there's a balance there because what the new tenancy will be is a kind of easier to use, clearer, simpler tenancy than the current one. We'll also provide a model tenancy agreement, so that should make it easier in terms of having standard agreements to use, which for a letting agent might be in terms of thinking about the sort of cost benefits, that might be beneficial to them. So I think in terms of kind of what they've raised, they've kind of noted it, but it's not something that they've actually came to in terms of the same conclusion in our assessment in the financial memorandum.
I note the in terms of awareness raising and training, yep. You anticipate costs to local authorities to be nil. Now, some of the evidence received, Glasgow in particular, say demand for information is more likely to be sourced at a local level, and we would suggest that a proportion of the campaign funds be targeted to would-be PRS customers in partnership with locally based or council-wide organisations. So I just wonder if you feel that nil on local authorities is a true reflection of the likely impact there, because there may be that letting agents or landlords would go to the local authority for information rather than perhaps looking at a national level, and therefore there might be a cost impact.
Okay. Well, I mentioned earlier about the extensive consultation that we've done and how close we work with local authorities, in particular Latchford and Causal. So I won't go over that again. But needs to say, you know, we have done in the development of the bill and the financial memorandum that supports it. There's not many local authorities that have brought this to attention, but you're right, Glasgow is one. In terms of our assumptions in the financial memorandum, we have allocated the Scottish Government a marketing budget for basically, in effect, spreading the word of landlords and tenants, as well as for helping advice bodies and representative bodies with training so that they're prepared to help tenants and landlords when the changes set out in the bill occur, subject to the bill of Parliament. So we were assuming that we would do most of that legwork, but clearly it's now something which a local authority is kind of brought to our attention now that they've seen the bill and considered the detail. And I mentioned earlier that I'm actually meeting with Glasgow in a couple of weeks' time, so that'll be one of the things which I'm no doubt be discussing with them. I mean, I think ultimately what's important here is that there is a facility to be able to ensure that subject to the Bill of Parliament, if the when the new tenancy comes into effect, that landlords, tenants, and everyone else involved understand it and are able to kind of use it.
I mean, I just wanted to come to the evidence from Alatro, which I think ties into this, and they talk about the practical experience from the last time significant changes were made to the law, where they say many landlords, estate agents, solicitors and property managers were very slow to properly understand the changes and reflect them in their day-to-day practices. They say that this remains a sector characterised by its atomisation, with many landlords in particular operating without any regular professional assistance or support. And obviously that may then lead to a burden on, for example, private sector housing officers within local authorities, who may be the go-to people for those landlords who do not have who are not operating within a wider organisation and have that support readily to hand. So I just wonder, again, what input you've had from these areas around the likely impact that they're in terms of workload and obviously subsequent cost.
It's not been something that's been raised by Alatro and until now, but again, I think that's because obviously they've seen the bill and the policy detail. I mean, I think first of all, Alatro responded very positively to, they actually responded very positively to both consultations, and I think they seem to welcome the broad thrust of the proposals as set out in the bill. I think they're broadly speaking supportive of what we're looking to do, although they have raised a couple of areas to discuss further. I think if I'm right, when they refer to the last time, they're referring to the last time there was a change in the tenancy regime, which would be the late 80s. So it is a different world that we're in now, but nonetheless, clearly it's important to be able to kind of look back and to kind of learn sort of any lessons that we can from the last time that there was such a change, and I think really there's kind of two areas that kind of this covers. The first one is the potential impact on local authorities, having looked at the evidence provided to the committee, I think that clearly it's something we'll discuss further as the bill is implemented. But if you think about the policy that this bill is providing, it's about improving security for tenants with the appropriate safeguards for landlords, lenders and investors. So the potential impact in some areas, such as homelessness, is likely to be there'll be less pressure on homelessness from the PRS because tenants will have more security of tenure. So there may well be that in thinking about if there's areas where there might be issues around, from a local authority's perspective, demand coming to them. There might be other areas where there's less demand because of what the policy is seeking to achieve. There's also another point as well about, I think, just kind of really in terms of the discussion with locals about what we'd normally expect them to do as business as usual and what they may look to see themselves as being more than business as usual. So taking a point about training, clearly new tenancy, local authorities will need to know what the new tenancy is and to understand it. So to what point does a change in legislation move from something which, for example, a lawyer might use as part of their continual professional development into something which is actually beyond that and something which, for example, the government might want to look to contribute towards training. We're very open to discussing these matters further with both Alacho and COSLA. And as I said at the start, we have outlined the budget and the financial memorandum that looks to basically provide for marketing and training and so on. On the training side, we were thinking principally around representative bodies and also advice agencies, but it may well be that there's something we can work within that for local authorities as well if they make a good case to us that's something which would benefit them.
Just want to touch finally on the issue around student accommodation, which has been well aired, but there's an area of that, mm-hmm. that I'm interested in, which perhaps goes slightly wider, but many students who are in private lets are also in houses of multiple occupation, and many individuals who are in houses of multiple occupation, students or otherwise, they don't always begin their tenancies at exactly the same time as one another, and therefore that will give not just varying start dates to those tenancies but also varying end dates if they're on a 12-month tenancy. Now, you've spoken about landlord engagement and landlord monitoring of tenancies, but if a landlord is operating a number of HMOs where there are a number of variations in terms of start and end dates, that obviously creates a burden on that landlord from an administrative perspective, which might not have previously been the case. Have you looked into that at all?
My understanding is that in the HMO sector, the tenancies that are currently used tend to be joint tenancies. And so, in effect, everybody joins and starts at tenancy at the same time under this regime and then leaves. And that's something which, under the new tenancy will still be provided for.
Jackie, to be followed by Jean.
I just have one brief question.
Okay.
And I want to return to the question of fees and legal aid for tribunals, because there is no mechanism for a financial memorandum with secondary legislation, and therefore your intention is to deliver this through secondary legislation, and I'm assuming tell us the cost then.
It's not my intention because it's not my policy area.
On behalf of the Minister.
I know. I think I can only say as much as well. I've probably said all I can on that. I've indicated that ministers intend to consult on fees and what the position is on legal aid. And what's important for what we've set out in the bill is that when those decisions are taken, then they will apply to the bill when we're looking to commence later in 2017.
Quite a substantial part of the bill, and I would have thought that it would have been helpful to provide estimates. Now, I accept fees is a matter that you wish to consult on, and that's fair enough. But the question of legal aid touches on the public purse. It is a hard-pressed budget. Are you saying to me there have been no estimates at all to inform the Minister's decision about whether to afford legal aid or not?
I'm going to answer that question. With reference to the bill, that's not something we've considered for this bill. In terms of the broader policy, that's something which I'm not able to provide an answer on, other than what I've said to the committee already.
Okay, I think it would be helpful for the committee convener if we knew whether there was, if it's not your policy area, somebody else's, that these costings have been done, and albeit they may be broad estimates to inform the Minister, I think it would be useful information for this committee.
Agreed. Jean, to be followed by Richard.
Thank you. I really just wanted to ask you about market rents and
And what that means, I accept the premise of the bill is to be have a much much more simplified and clearer and fairer system of tenancy and private rents. But if I go back in my own history, I do remember sharing a flat with five other girls in Edinburgh, and the landlord put the rent up by 50%, and we called somebody, I think was known as the rent adjuster at that time, who came along with the property owner and agreed a 20% increase in the rent, which we accepted and he accepted, and everybody went away, and that was the end of it. How will we see fairer rents through in this bill in terms of, and it would affect the, I think, the financial memorandum in terms of outcomes of appeals and tribunals and so on in the same situation? I mean, what, in other words, is the market rent whatever anybody can get for it? Whatever the property owner can whatever rent he or she can attract for that property is okay by everybody?
So I think the way we've described it in the financial memorandum is that rents are market-led, so basically a willing landlord, a willing tenant agreeing what the price would be. Of course, if that happens numerous times, then that creates averages which will give market information on what the market rent is. In terms of what we provide for in the bill, then tenants will be able to seek adjudication. For example, in the scenario you said, 50% seems quite a large increase. They'd be able to go to Rent Service Scotland, who would then determine whether or not that increase was fair or reasonable, and what they would have in reference to when determining that would be, well, what are the people paying for other similar comparable properties? And the Rent Service Scotland have got a lot of experience in doing that sort of thing. So that's the kind of position on market rents.
The other thing, I mean, I suppose Scotland has changed dramatically in as much as I think I'm right in saying that at one point we were over 70% of people lived in social housing in Scotland. That has changed because that housing sector, although it's coming back into play, hasn't been there. And therefore there's been a dramatic growth in the last 30, 40 years of the rented sector. Have we looked at countries that have always had a private rented sector and seem to work very well? Germany comes to mind, Holland or the Netherlands, where that has been the norm, and what the relationship is there between, because people, I think, have lived in the same house all their lives through the rented sector, which is not something that we're used to in Scotland.
I mean, yes, that's a good and an interesting question. I think that we have. The short answer is we have. I've got a copy here, but this is a strategy that the Scottish Government produced, published in 2013. It was developed in consultation with stakeholders through the private rented sector strategy group. We consulted on that and then informed the Scottish Government's final strategy. And that basically sets out what we're looking to achieve in the PRS and how we're going to do that. One of the actions in there, by the way, is to review the tenancy regime, which follows on to where we are today. Other countries do have private rented sectors. You mentioned Germany. They're the often cited example of a country with a large private rented sector, where folk tend to kind of look at it as a kind of more attractive option and stay in the longer term. It's interesting looking at the evidence around that because there's reasons for that, some of which are cultural, some of which to do with the broader fiscal sort of framework and incentives that the Germans provide to landlords. But I think, ultimately what we're looking to achieve in the PRS in Scotland is to have a sector which is attractive to everybody who wants to live in it or invest in it or who works associated with it, for it to be a kind of positive choice for those who want to kind of stay, which it is for many, but not always for everyone at present. And that's why we're looking to make the changes that we're making, including this new tenancy, which will improve security for tenants with appropriate safeguards for the landlords, lenders and investors.
Thank you.
Richard.
Thank you, Camille. I want to turn to the issue of of students and their tenancies in the future, because I think some important issues have been touched on here in previous questions. I appreciate the intention is to keep rents down, including for students, which is welcome. But I worry about unintended consequences. And so, you know, I mean, could you not envisage a scenario, for example, where if a student, you know, you hope there'll be good liaison dialogue between the landlord and the student, and then, as you said, a tenancy comes to an end, mutually agreed, which benefits both parties, and it can work as it does normally. But if it doesn't, and I mean, obviously that can happen, and if somebody moves on to that rolling contract, that indefinite agreement, and they walk away for whatever reason in September, October, rather than in an organised fashion in June, July, that landlord's left high and dry because they've missed out on that student market, and that can make a big difference to whether they can, at what rent they can let that property out. Now, if landlords go through that experience on a number of occasions and they decide, well, no, this is just not for us, we can't, you know, live with this model anymore, and they walk away, isn't there a danger then you actually get reduced supply and new people come in, but come in at a higher level, and they start off immediately charging higher rents, and potentially, I think as the university touched on, there could be actually a situation where, because of such legislation, in fact, students might be paying higher rents. I mean, how far have you worked through that scenario, and to what extent have you consulted on the potential for that to happen?
Okay, well, and what we're saying in the financial memorandum is that we accept that at some sort of submarkets of the PRS, we'll need to adapt based on what we're intending to do in terms of the new tenancy. But we don't see that as being a fundamental adaptation. So things can change. So as a fundamental adaptation, so things can change, and still landlords will still be able to basically do what's ultimately most important to them, which is to effectively manage the properties, and also to be able to kind of, if they're looking at their properties as an investment, to be able to realise that investment in one way or the other. I mean, really what this comes down to is, at the moment, a landlord can say, if the vicious or short should tenancy, that the tenant has to leave at a certain point. And more often than not, they do. But sometimes they don't, and it can take months for a legal eviction to take place. That's one of the reasons why we're looking to kind of move to the more accessible specialist tribunal system, which is something which landlords have broadly supported. Under this new system, then landlords will have grounds. We don't expect the pattern to really change much. So most students, and this is backed by, for example, the representative body of National Union Students, most students would you know, if they're looking to stay for 9 months, they look to stay for 9 months. They don't want to be paying rent on somewhere where they're not actually staying. If they're not going to be staying there, they'll look to give notice and move. And landlords will be able to kind of sort of look to rent out that property for the following year, as I mentioned earlier. The worst case scenario from a landlord's point of view is they'd have 8 weeks, but with good engagement, they could have more than 8 weeks. Because once the tenant has confirmed what they're intended to do, then the landlord will have that certainty that they currently have now. So really, if you look at what the actual change is, it seems, you know, obviously it's rebalancing the relationship between tenants and landlords to some extent. So it's not quite as favourable from a landlord's perspective in terms of how they can currently manage their property, but it's not something which fundamentally changes their ability to kind of do what, you know, they want to do in terms of letting out property. And I think there's one final thing which is really quite important, is that the short-assured tenancy doesn't work that well. And one of the reasons why, and this is actually one of the areas, was broad consensus with stakeholders, is actually the short-assured tenancy doesn't work too well. It's complex. It's very hard to really know if you've done it right. Now, the sector works in a way now that most tenants, and we've said that in the financial memorandum, will look to kind of leave the tenancy, maybe about 90% or so. So in most cases, a landlord really wouldn't know if they've done it right or not. But there are instances where landlords think they've got a short-assured tenancy and therefore a no-fault ground, but then they realise that the paperwork's not been done properly and they don't. And so, you know, I think that there are benefits, therefore, to having a clearer, simpler system which will support, we believe, a more professionally managed, high-quality private sector that inspires consumer confidence and is attractive to to attract an investment.
In the US, and quite rightly they've raised this with us on a number of occasions, is the amount of rent students are paying, which has clearly been far too high. But in terms of the 9-month contracts, that arrangement seems to work broadly quite well. I mean, why didn't you give any consideration to separate arrangements for students in consultation with NUS and other bodies? Or did you give any consideration?
Well, we have discussed this with stakeholders. Stakeholders have made the various positions known to us, and ultimately, what as I said earlier on, it kind of comes down to is that we want we said we're going to have a more simple, clearer system, so one tenancy, which is clear and simple to use than the current arrangements, and that everyone who's on the current assured system will transfer across to the new system. And ministers have said that their position is that they want all tenants who are transferring across to have the same rights under the new system as they currently have under the old. So I think what I'm saying is that they wouldn't want to differentiate students from other tenants in a way which would potentially provide them with less rights than other tenants in the PRS.
I think the thing is, I probably not want students to pay higher rents. And my concern, Mr. Stalker, is that you said you've engaged in consultation on this, but the University of Edinburgh clearly are not reassured. This won't disrupt on the rental market, and I simply therefore convene to say, I think it's worthwhile us knowing why that they still feel a bit of disruption. And I think, from my point of view as a committee member, I'd like to be reassured that these changes, which are clearly well intentioned and clearly want to have good rights as tenants, but fundamentally they don't want to pay higher rents. And I just don't think I've received assurance that I want to have this won't have that unintended consequence.
Okay, well, we've consulted broadly for two full public consultations. I have, and the bill team have engaged with the broad spectrum of stakeholders, including those that provide university accommodation. And in answer to the question that was asked earlier about the specific question that the University of Edinburgh had asked about, would they still be exempt? I've provided an answer to that. Yeah.
Thanks. I mean, I think, a lot of landlords might just say, we're just going to give them a 12-month tenancy and the students are going to have to pay for 12 months and that's going to be it, rather than all this engagement, with the students and all this kind of stuff, which frankly for a lot of them I think is going to be too much more trouble than it's worth. At the end of the day, the students are the ones that I think could lose out here. But I want to just touch on just one thing that's not been really covered, but settling questions, but you did touch on it a wee bit yourself in your last answer. First of all, though, I would say that you said that some submarkets will need to adapt, and our concern is that they may adapt in terms of providing less supply, and that's the thing I want to just touch on. I mean, the Scottish Association of Landlords said in terms of the loss of the no-fault ground, this element of discretion may prolong the time it takes to evict the tenant, the new legislation, and ultimately if the tribunal does not award possession, it may result in the landlord being forced to continue the tenancy despite the fact the tenant is breaching the terms of the tenancy. They then go on to say, where the tenant has stopped paying the rent, currently repossession can often be achieved in 2 to 3 months. Under proposals, we estimate it may take a landlord at least 5 months to recover possession from a non-paying tenant. Clearly this will have a big financial implications for landlords in terms of lost revenue. And again, the issue there obviously is, supply, and will people want to enter such a market, given that there's 146,000 landlords and they all have an average of 2.5 flats. I know some have got dozens, but a lot only have one. So it's the small people I'm thinking about here. Now, you said in the reply to Richard, you said that you seem to be of the view that this legislation would make it quicker to process an eviction in such a case. Did I pick you up right on that? Because that's not what the landlords seem to think.
The landlord's perspective view on the tribunal is that they are supportive of the tribunal because it's a more accessible and specialist form of redress compared to the courts. So this comes back to the 2014 Housing Act, where both Scots Association of Landlords and Scottish Land Estates said, given evidence to the committee that they were supportive of that. One of the reasons for that is that where, and it doesn't happen that often, or less often than you think, but where a landlord does have to go to court through the court system, then it can take some time, particularly for one of the main reasons that landlords tend to go to courts, which is for rent arrears. So, you know, I think that, you know, they've said then, and I think they still continue to support the first tier tribunal as an effective place of redress for both tenants and landlords.
Know where there's going to be fees, where there's going to be legal aid. We don't know how many people are going to try and access system, because those will make a huge impact on the number of people. You know, I mean, if there's not going to be any cost to tenants, you're going to get a lot more people actually, you know, going to tribunal than if they have to pay a cost and if they don't get legal aid. So how can you then be confident that the time to process applications, when you don't know how many there's going to be and what circumstance they'll be under, will be less than the current situation?
Okay, I'm going to ask my colleague Charles if I may just outline what was set out in the Financial Memorandum on the potential demand from the change in policy on the first tribunal. But basically, from what I've said earlier, then obviously that is an assessment based on currently the position of there not being a decision on fees, therefore no fees, and also what I've said earlier about legal aid. But Charles, would you mind outlining the numbers that we expect?
I think we do have a fairly good idea of the number of cases we expect, and in the financial memorandum it's just over 1,100, and we base that figure on the operation of the private residential tenancies board in Ireland. So the figures that we have quoted in the financial memorandum are based upon a tribunal system that's up and running currently. Therefore, I suppose, in an evidence-based point of view, there's no reason to expect a particular surge around those if that's what's happening in another country with a similar-sized PRS system.
Ireland, do they get legal aid and other fees?
I'm not sure on the question of legal aid, but I know that they do charge a fee in Ireland, yes.
Yeah, so if there's no fee here, then that 1,100 number would be significantly increased, plus the population in Scotland is bigger. I don't know if the rental market's larger. You're talking about 368,000 properties here, 146,000 landlords in Scotland. Are the figures comparable with the Republic of Ireland?
Well, with the PRS in Scotland is slightly bigger than in Ireland, and we did uplift our estimate to reflect the larger size of the PRS in Scotland. So we have done that.
Just one last question. If there's no fee, what impact do you think that would have on the number of people applying for the tribunals?
I can answer that question. If there's no fee, we've set out in the financial memorandum. That's the figures that would that's the figures that we've assessed and provided for that.
But based on what? I mean, based on legal aid, getting legal aid and not getting legal aid.
Okay, just for clarity.
There's too many imponderables here, I think. You know.
Right. So just to be clear, the assessment we've set in the financial memorandum is assuming no fees, and we've not assumed legal aid either. But that's not to say it might not happen. It's just that's the model, that's what we've put into the model when we've basically produced the numbers.
Thank you very much. Okay, that's concluded our questions. Are there any further points you want to make to committee before we wind up?
No.
Okay, well, thank you very much for your time and for answering our questions in such detail. I'm now going to call a brief natural break until 11:50 to enable a changeover of witnesses. Our next piece of business is to take evidence from Anne McTaggart, MSP, in relation to the financial memorandum accompanying her Member's Bill. Ms McTaggart is joined today by Diane Barr for the Non-Government Bills Unit. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite Ms McTaggart to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Committee Members. And good morning, I shall still say it's still morning, nearly there. And I'd like to thank you all and the committee for the opportunity to provide evidence today on the Transplantation, Authorisation of Removal of Organs, etc. Scotland Bill, and for allowing me to submit supplementary evidence just as recently as over the last few weeks. I know that the committee's focus is on financial aspects of the bill. However, I just wanted to take a few moments to explain why this bill is necessary and why I have introduced it. There are currently 571 people in Scotland waiting for a transplant. Demand for organs far outweighs the number of organs being donated. As a result of three people die each day in the UK who are in need of an organ transplant, this is far too many. Many more face years of ill health, often with no guarantee of there being a suitable donor. This needs to change. I believe that a soft opt-out system of organ donation is the solution. Calls for an opt-out system are not new. Members of this Parliament, and indeed members of this very committee, have considered this issue many times over the years. I want to commend the work done by all the MSPs from all parties to highlight this important issue, work that has helped to inform this bill, and more importantly, give those awaiting a transplant and their families hope. This is not a party political issue. This is about saving lives. The bill introduces a soft opt-out system of organ donation in Scotland. According to international evidence, a soft opt-out system can lead to an increase in organ donations of between 25 and 30%. The financial memorandum focuses on the costs of implementing this bill, and much of that evidence the committee has received also focuses on these costs. However, we should not lose sight of the potential gains. Needing an organ does not have any boundaries. It can happen to anyone. If you have ever spoken to anyone who has received an organ donation, you will know how transformational it can be. It is not too strong to say that it can be a matter of life and death. The Scottish Government and I share the same ambition: more donors, more more transplants, and more lives saved. That ambition will not be realised without investment and change. The financial memorandum provides a best estimate of the expected costs. In my letter to you, I have provided a revised estimate of £6.8 million with details of each area of spend. I believe that this is a realistic and accurate assessment of the costs of implementing this bill. The written evidence received by the committee suggests that most agree with me also. Some of the best performing countries in the world for donation and transplant rates have a soft opt-out system. Support is growing with the recent introduction of soft opt-out system in Wales, and the Northern Ireland Assembly has recently agreed stage one of an opt-out bill. Scotland has led the way on so many other health issues. We should be leading and on organ donation too. Let's not limit our ambition for Scotland. Let's lead the charge and not wait and wait and wait. Don't put on hold the lives of those waiting for an organ donation. Thank you for listening, and I welcome now to answer your questions to help us make this bill possible. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. And I know it's your first time in the Finance Committee, so what will happen, as I'm sure you're probably aware, is I'll ask some opening questions and then colleagues around the tables will around the table will then come in. The first question is really from the submission from the Scottish Government. A number of questions you'll understand will be from that, because it was obviously the most detailed submission. And you're right, a lot of the people who submitted evidence more or less said there was no real impact as they saw it. So we'll focus on the organisation that said it would, which is the Scottish Government. And you said in your opening statement that what you want, and I think what we would all want to see with this legislation that goes through, is more donors, more transplantations, and to reduce the number of people who are actually waiting, particularly those whose lives are threatened. But in paragraph 4, the Scottish Government said that the bill does not provide an estimate for the number of additional donors nor transplants that legislation would lead to. So what's your response to that? Has any work been done to see what impact you think it would actually have on that?
Yep, thank you, Convener. The estimate that we have provided is what we would call, and we would thank the Scottish Government for, because they were able to give some of that detailed information and costings that we weren't able to provide up until they did. We are unable, given the fact that we're unable to put a cost on people's lives. The Scottish Government have gave their best estimate, and we have looked at that as part of myself and Diane in the Bill Committee. We have looked at that as the best estimate. The actual costs, which FAR have provided to the actual costs incurred by the Welsh Government for the soft opt legislation, and we have taken a lot from their information and used it towards our bill. Obviously, we've adapted that because we have a greater population. The costs of additional transplant operations arising from the bill are far more difficult to quantify. Indeed, in its submission to the committee, the Scottish Government acknowledges that despite the NHS National Service Division having undertaken a great deal of work to forecast the potential costs of additional transplant arising from the government's own donation and transplant plan for Scotland over the period of 2020, it was, and I quote, not in a position to provide any robust estimate of financial cost savings to the NHS and to Scotland. As a result of the possible 25 to 30% increase in organ donation for implementing a soft opt-out system. So although in its written evidence, the National Service Division says that it would expect to manage any increased activity within the existing portfolio.
Thanks for that. I mean, I think the issue of cost, I mean, obviously you've kind of answered my next question almost about when the government said it's impossible to accurately assess the cost of the proposed measures from the limited information contained within the financial memorandum. And I have to say here on the record that I do think that individual members who bring forward bills with the best intentions don't have access to perhaps all the information that perhaps they should in putting together bills, and that's an issue that as a parliament we should be looking to. But in terms of what we've got in front of us, I'll go back to the question I asked. I mean, one of the things I was wanting to know, Anne, is about the number of additional donors and transplants that legislation would lead to. In other words, from the evidence in Wales and elsewhere, how many more people do you think are likely to come forward? How many more people more organs are likely to be available for transplant as a result of this because of the...
Apologies for not covering that initially. We do have the figures, and it's expected that there will be, as I said, 25 to 30% increase. This could actually mean, and I think this is the figure that you were looking for, it was additional 24 to 29 donors per year, an additional 75 to 90 operations per year. Obviously, depending on how many organs will be removed from each person will obviously equate to how many operations that will take.
Well, thanks very much. That's very helpful. Now, one of the issues that's also come up is the role of the authorised investigating officer. Basically, the kind of questions that have been submitted here is that this role doesn't really exist, and it's about, you know, how much would that really cost, what training would they require, and what kind of people would apply. I'm just wondering if you can give us just a wee, I don't know, kind of summary of what you think that this job would entail and how much it would really kind of cost, because obviously it's a new position.
Convener, thank you. The authorised investigatory person, you'll see from the Scottish Government's estimate and from their financial memorandum, they have created a whole new tier. We have not done that, and we have not done that because, quite simply, we don't see that there's a need for to create a whole new mass of people. There are people currently working in this role just now. They're called senior nurse of organ donation. We call them SNODs. Those people do have the skills. Those people are working within that job. And it's just about enhancing that role and extending that role that they are currently doing. So we do not see that figure that the Scottish Government have placed. And, you know, they've chosen to select that option, and I see that as the kind of least preferred option and the most expensive option. And we would normally say in our trade, you know, that's the kind of Rolls-Royce model that they have chosen. Creating a new role is not a requirement of this bill. And therefore, the financial memorandum is not missing the costs from it, because we don't reckon that it should be.
OK, I'm just going to ask you one further question, and then I'm going to open it out to colleagues around the table. And it's just, so we think that we're only focusing on what the Scottish Government's got to say. You know, we have one of our submissions that we actually have is from the local Lothian, NHS Lothian, and they've said as a service provider they will be disproportionately impacted by the bill, and there's a certain uncertainty over the impact of levels of transplantation activity we've undertaken. I think you've really touched on that latter point, but I'm just wondering how, if you've done any work to look at how individual health boards might be affected as opposed to the kind of national picture a wee bit, specifically in terms of Lothian.
The costs met from the NHS board's budget, and paragraph 25 of the financial memorandum confirms that most of the additional costs are expected to fall on the Scottish Government's health budget, and that its contribution to the NHSBT should not change. This is similar to the Welsh Government's approach, and I refer the committee to the confirmation and that the Scottish Government's submission that the NHS National Service Division has undertaken detailed consultation with NHS boards to ensure that these resources will be made available to support the additional costs related to meeting the Scottish Government's targets.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Deputy Convener?
Also, you want to say anything extra on that, Diane?
There was just the evidence from NHS National Services Division that they confirm that additional costs related to the implementation of the bill would be met. They say that if there were to be an increase in transplantation activity as a result of this bill, National Services Division would expect to manage this within its existing financial portfolio. So there doesn't look like there'd be additional costs that couldn't be met.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that. Deputy Convener?
Thanks, Convener. I mean, probably best continuing in that theme just now, because we had Lothian I might come back to, but the Western Isles, in particular, NHS Western Isles, in their submission, seem to feel that they would be disadvantaged, because obviously they're one of the smaller ones. They're not carrying out any actual transplants themselves, and seem to get recharged, as I understand it, from other health boards who do the work. So, I mean, if we just think of them for a minute, how would they be affected? How would you see them being affected?
It's about trying to offset some of the savings, and you're right, not only would the Western Isles, and I'm not sure if they wouldn't benefit in a sense, it's a UK-wide, we are signed up to a UK-wide organ transplantation delivery, so those costs would be met throughout, and it's not always that some of the organs. In fact, some of the organs that are transplanted in some of the people perhaps from Western Isles or within Scotland don't necessarily come from a deceased person in Scotland. They are UK-wide.
So there would be a saving. As I understand it, dialysis would be one of the main savings. But in other cases, there aren't such obvious savings if somebody gets a transplant.
That's right. The dialysis, you're right to touch on that. There is currently 571 people awaiting a transplant in Scotland. 425 of those people are waiting on a kidney transplant, and that is 74%. There is a potential for savings from the majority of the transplant operations. And the Western Isles could be, they will be part of that. The kidney, I can talk about most if you're wanting more information about how much that would save. They are the greatest amount, they're 74% of the people awaiting, and they do. That's where a lot of the money is perhaps not made, but offset from kidney dialysis, the costing of how much it would cost if a person didn't get a kidney transplant, about the ongoing costs.
Yeah. I agreed with your opening comments, and I'm very sympathetic towards the bill, but obviously this committee has to look fairly carefully at costs and potential savings. I think it's Annex B of the government's response was quite blunt at one point, where it said, we are required, however, to make the point that with the exception of kidney transplants, patients who do not receive a transplant will die, and therefore they would not have ongoing costs. So would you accept in principle, without getting into all the detail, that for some patients, if they do get a transplant, that will actually mean that there will be a cost? They'll have a quality of life which they wouldn't have had before, but there will be ongoing costs which they wouldn't have had before.
The ongoing costs which would offset how much that would cost. Could I give you some of those figures, Mr. Mason? The cost benefit of a kidney transplantation compared to dialysis is £24,100 per year. And well, that over a 10-year period is, user in the finance committee and good at the maths, it's £241,000 over a 10-year period. And an example of that, there's 153 transplants were performed in Scotland in 2014-2015, representing a cost saving of approximately £3.7 million or £37 million over the 10-year period.
That's specifically for kidney?
Yes.
Yes. But it's the exception. For the others, if somebody gets a transplant, basically, if we just look at the NHS and leave aside quality of life and all the rest of it, it would mean a higher cost for the NHS ongoing.
Yes, and that's where we aim. That's where they would aim to offset that with the kidney savings costs. And we are only talking about 26%, aren't we?
Okay, thank you. I mean, going back to Lothian, they gave us quite a full range of comments. One of their points was the bill does not explicitly highlight the additional cost of organ retrieval and transportation. Would you consider that a major point, or is that quite minor?
Sorry, Mr. Mason.
It was towards the end of the Lothian submission. They said the bill does not explicitly highlight the additional costs of organ retrieval and transportation. Do you accept that? Or is it minor?
If additional investment in retrieval services is required, this is a matter for the Scottish Government, for them to decide.
Okay.
How the savings are redistributed within the NHS would be for the Scottish Government also, and for the NHS to determine. I don't think within the realms of the bill that I would be able to answer that.
So is your kind of argument, because there's Lothian stuff here as well, that although we're getting individual feedback from the individual boards, they're unable to look at the whole picture, and whereas you and the bill are looking at the whole picture? Is that the logic?
Yes. I wouldn't foresee many of the health boards writing to tell you that they will be able to gladly be able to splash cash on and have a wash of cash around. I don't think many health boards would be writing in any kind of evidence that that would be the case. So I think they've gave what they reckon, but yes, you're exactly right. I have looked at the overall picture for Scotland wide.
Okay, I accept that. And I think probably my final point then, again, NHS Lothian, their quote was that as a service provider of both transplantation and organ retrieval, because I think they do some of the stuff nationally, NHS Lothian will be disproportionately impacted by the bill. So, again, is that the same answer that although they might be disproportionately impacted, the overall picture will be more neutral?
I think we're going over the same question because, you know, I see it as an overall broader picture, and it is about it wouldn't boil down to me, you know, if the person in the Western Isles or the person in Lothian was needing that transplant and the cost that I look at it as an overall picture as Scotland wide as opposed to each individual
health board. Right. Okay, thanks so much.
Okay, Gavin to be followed by Jackie.
So quite a lot of stakeholders seem to agree with your financial memorandum, but obviously, as has been touched on, the one I suppose the one where there's a bit of a difference is the Scottish Government, which first impression it looks like a massive difference, but actually when you realise it's over a 10-year period, it's quite a big difference in percentage terms, but not so big in absolute terms year on year. You're saying it's going to be 680,000 a year, and they're saying it's going to be 2.2 million a year over a 10-year period. But nonetheless, there is a difference. The first one, they cite two differences. One has been touched on, it's this authorised investigating person. Right, so the Scottish Government have put an estimate for that of £10.9 million over a 10-year period. You've described that as a Rolls Royce, and you think there are other options that would do that. You referred to something called SNODs. Would there be any? I guess you've assumed the cost will be nil for that. But what's your assumption of costs for if you go for the SNOD option instead of the AIP option? What's the cost implications?
Yeah, I've put that under the training cost.
Okay.
Because I've never. I've kind of said, you know, that that would be the Rolls Royce model for to bring in an additional whole set a different team. The people that are doing it just now are the SNODs, but with enhanced training, and we've put that training bill down. I think it's 0.5 million.
Yeah. Okay, so your view is because the Scottish Government basically are saying they reckon they would need 18 AIPs. Your view is you could use existing staff, they'd have to be trained and there'd be a cost implication for that, but you don't think there would be any new staff required. You think it could be done from existing people, as it were.
And not only do I not think that there would be new staff required, but it would be a different system then if we did bring in an extra layer of staff. That would be a different system from what's been operated elsewhere. So I'm not really sure why you would bring in that additional team, in a sense. The Welsh Government haven't put that in, and that they're ready to roll out as of December. That's not the case there, so I'm not really sure how that would work out, given that we are UK-wide service, how that would work out. Would a SNOD then be up, you know, the SNOD would be able to do it down there, but we would be calling them something different up here? And a different role. I'm not really sure how that would work out, and I don't think it would work out. That's why we've not looked at that option.
Okay. And you mentioned Wales. In terms of, so Wales haven't gone live yet. They will go live next month. In terms of what they're planning to do, though, are they basically following the model that you've got in the bill, as it were? They're not having AIPs, as the Scottish Government suggested. They're doing effectively what you've outlined.
Yes, most certainly. And we have, I've worked with and I've spoken with some of the drafters from the Welsh Government and also from the Northern Ireland. We do regularly meet up to try and piece this together as much as we can for to make it as best a bill as we possibly can. So, no, the Welsh Government haven't included AIPs separately, and neither have I.
Okay. And, I mean, Northern Ireland, I guess, are behind Wales but ahead of us, but they, as far as you understand it, their approach is similar to what you're suggesting as well. Okay.
Yes.
So that takes care of, the biggest financial difference between you and the Scottish Government. There is a second one, though, which they describe as ongoing publicity. Now, you have set funds aside in the financial memo, I think something to the tune of £2.8 million for the publicity that would be required for this. The Scottish Government, I think, seem to accept, or broadly similar to you in terms of the initial publicity, but they've set aside a total of, they estimate a total of £4.9 million over and above you, for ongoing publicity for the 8 years, following the initial two. Their argument being that particularly people reaching the age of 16 would need a specific communication, anyone new coming to the country and so on, with a general refresher. Now, you've not got that figure in there. I mean, can you just explain, the difference between your thinking and the Scottish Government thinking?
Thank you. Yes, I can. The Scottish Government has an obligation under Section 1(1)(b) of the Human Tissue Scotland Act 2006 to, quote, promote information and awareness about the donation for transplantation of parts of a human body. Now, to meet this obligation, the Scottish Government has an annual organ donation advertising budget. It is reasonable to assume that any recurring campaign costs related to the organ donation would be included within that annual budget, and that no separate advertising budget would be required. So that's simply why we haven't put it within the financial memorandum. Therefore, any recurring organ donation advertising campaigning costs are not additional expenditure attributable to the bill and were not included in the financial memorandum. The financial memorandum includes the most up-to-date organ donation advertising spend information that was available, which was £527,000 for the year 2012-2013.
Okay, so your view is the bill does lead to an increase in advertising spend for year one and year two, but in years 3 to 10, the bill doesn't have an impact on advertising spend.
Yes, you're right.
Okay, all right, thank you. All right,
okay. thank you, Convener. I've just got two questions. One is a follow-up about the authorised investigating person, because NHS Blood and Transplant, in their submission, suggested that it would cost around £1.1 million per year to ensure 24-hour availability of such nurses 365 days a year. So they seem to accept, you know, your premise that you don't need a whole new bunch of people. There are existing people. They've not commented, I don't think, adversely on the amount allowed for training, but they seem to be suggesting these people need to be 24 hours a day, and I wonder whether you wouldn't comment on that.
Thank you. £1.1 million is the NHS BT's estimate of employing that additional 18 staff as authorised investigating persons. I'll say it again, it's not a requirement of the bill, as you are probably well aware by now. That was not the NHS BT's approach to the implementation of the Welsh Bill soft opt-out legislation, where it updated the policies and processes of the senior nurses, which is SNODs, and the clinical leads, which they are called CLODs, to reflect the changes to their roles. As the NHS BT provides a UK-wide service, I would expect it to provide a similar approach in Scotland.
So they've done it in Wales, they can do it in Scotland. Okay, that's very helpful to know. Finally, let me turn to Wales for a minute, because the Scottish Government, not unreasonably, wants us to wait, wants us to evaluate, because the opt-out legislation in Wales is fairly recent. It's not unreasonable. Why shouldn't we wait?
The Welsh Government will be monitoring, and they have said, you know, well, they've not actually started, so they will be monitoring this process. They have started to monitor, sorry, but they haven't started the process. So they will be monitoring and evaluate the impact of the soft opt-out legislation over a five-year period and publish its final report in 2017, which is a long way away. The Scottish Government decision to wait for at least two more years, will have a financial impact on the NHS. Paragraph 31 of the Financial Memorandum makes clear kidney transplants do offset the cost of the transplant procedures due to the costs associated with the dialysis and the length of time a patient is expected to survive on the dialysis. And again, with 74% of the people awaiting kidney transplant, organ donation, that are waiting for kidneys, there will be a financial cost to the NHS in continuing the dialysis treatment for the 425 people waiting. In financial terms, that means £30,800 per patient per year. In terms of the potential financial savings, there would be 609 kidney transplants took place, of which it saved the NHS £145 million in dialysis costs. Waiting another at least another 2 years, because it could be longer than that, does not only incur a financial cost, the cost to the people, that's the real cost, I'm afraid. The longer the wait, the greater the number of people who are either taken off the waiting list because they're so poorly, or like I'm sure the convener mentioned earlier, or they pass away for being so ill.
Oh, the deputy mentioned that.
Sorry, deputy.
I'm too sensitive to mention such issues.
Sorry.
Thank you very much, convener.
Thank you very much. That appears to have exhausted the questions from the committee. Are there any further points you want to make before we wind up this session?
Oh, no more questions. I was just getting in the hang of it.
I can't force them, you know.
And I am in between now and lunch, aren't I? But I hope I have given the committee what has been required, and if any further information you do require, convener, as the committee, please do not hesitate, whereby I will get back to you in writing with the figures that we have and the information that we have.
Thanks very much, Shan. That's very helpful, that offer. And if we need to, we'll take that up. I'm just going to call a one-minute recess to allow our witnesses to depart, and then we'll move on to agenda item 3 straight away. Okay, folks, our final item of business is to report back on the recent fact-finding visit to the Basque Country by Richard, myself, along with, of course, Jim and Ross. Members have received copies of a short written report summarising our findings. I'm not going to go through it all, but I do want to highlight some points. Now, Richard, come in, and if there's anything he wants to add, he can feel free to do so. So the report summarises the key findings from our visit. The Basque Country, a fascinating part of Spain. It's less than a tenth the size of Scotland. It's got 2.2 million people. It comprises three very prosperous provinces. The level of productivity per person is 34.5% above the Spanish average. Its Human Development Index is higher than Iceland, Norway or Sweden. It's got less than 5% of Spain's population, but more than 6% of its GDP. And what is interesting is that the contribution the Basque Country makes to the Spanish state, which is fixed at 6.24%, known as a quota, it pays 6.24% of Spanish state expenditure in areas not devolved to the Basque Country. Now, the way this everything's been set up is through something called the Economic Agreement, which regulates the financial and tax relations between Spain of the Spanish state and the Basque Country. It derives from a historical power held in the Basque territories to regulate, manage and collect taxes, and it was certainly drummed into as we were there, that this goes back well into the mists of time and is part of their historic rights, which they feel very strongly. And as such, the Basque Country has a history of specific Basque tax system with its own treasury and collection infrastructure. And because the economic agreement is bilateral, the intergovernment machinery provides equal weighting to the Basque and Spanish representatives. And this bilateral relationship was considered key to the economic agreement. Nearly all politicians and officials we met were strongly supportive of the economic agreement. It was seen as an effective mechanism for governing, which has allowed the Basque Country to develop a successful and distinctive economic and industrial policy. There was agreement around a strong causal link between the economic agreement and the positive economic and social indicators evident in the Basque Country. For example, on GDP per capita, productivity, employment, research and development spend, inequality, and higher education participation, Basque Country outperforms Spain and the European Union average. A key message was that Scotland's taxpayers must be for purpose and usable. What is interesting as well is that it showed that there was a common Team Basque approach to be successful. And in terms of what we discussed last week, in terms of behavioural patterns and how taxation impacts on that, we did ask some questions of that. And despite the fact the Basque Country has higher personal income taxes than the rest of Spain, it was not perceived really to be an issue because of the quality of workforce, infrastructure and research and development investment, which were seen as far more critical. Richard, and then if anyone wants to ask questions.
Well, I think that's summed up the key points, Karina. I think it's important to place on record the fact that the Basque government and Parliament were so helpful to the committee in terms of our inquiries and in terms of providing us a huge amount of information, which was all very informative indeed. I think the key issue I took from it was the importance of that bilateral approach between the Basque government and the Spanish government, and the fact that while, there's certainly consensus in the Basque Country about the financial arrangements, about the economic agreement, it's disputed on the parts of Spain, but it has survived clearly because they have that bilateral approach to agreeing their tax regime, any disputes around that, and in terms of the broader economic policy. And so for me, what came out of that was that we are discussing in terms of the Scotland, the current Scotland bill, what will happen in terms of any disputes between the UK and Scottish government as a result of our new tax powers. And we've been debating whether we have some independent arbiter. But in fact, what the experience of the Basque Country is rather having these joint committees where there's equal representation between the Basque government and representatives of the Spanish government. And so I think that was a helpful model to examine and convene, and I think it's certainly something that we should take into account as we move forward in our considerations over the new fiscal framework. I think the final point you make very well, particularly in terms of their approach to personal taxation those issues, is that there was very little experience very little of an issue for them in terms of people moving from or to the Basque Country in terms of the in terms of that regime, and that other factors were far more important in terms of people coming to the Basque Country. But certainly, it's very clear they've had an economic success story there. And I think more broadly, there's things that we can learn from that.
Yes, I think the economic agreement has lasted now, 34 years with different governments in Madrid, and indeed the Basque Country shows how robust it is. And of course, while Madrid, like the UK government, constitutionally holds the upper hand, the Basques have significant bargaining power. And we said, what happens when there's this agreement? What does Spain do? And they kind of laughed and basically said, well, we collect the taxes, we've got the money in our pocket, so they have to work with us. And I think that equality of partnership really is very significant. I should also have said, it was a bit remiss of me not to do so, that they were to the level of assistance we were given was such that the finance minister, the day before he was to present the budget to Parliament, spent an hour and 45 minutes with us going through in great detail the way they actually work in terms of their fiscal framework, and indeed historically how they reached what they have actually done. So all of the Basque were extremely hospitable in terms of actually working with us and trying to help us, and they're quite keen on developing our relationship with Scotland and indeed other countries. Anyone get anything they wish to ask? Or
I mean, I'm interested that they haven't touched the quota since 1981.
Yes.
Now, that's equivalent, I guess, of the block grant adjustment, although it's going... the block grant, I mean, but it's going the other way.
Yeah.
But it's the balancing amount. Presumably that is quite a sensitive issue for them, as the block grant is for us.
I think it is. I think they will. They have 4.66% of the population, 6.07% of GDP, but they're expected to contribute 6.24%. But I think the view they have is that, given the difference between GDP and the quota, to kind of go to all the trouble of, you know, noising up the Spanish government and creating all sorts of political battles over that fairly small amount in relative terms, when they are doing much better than the rest of Spain, they feel it's not really a reason to actually quibble. And of course, if the Basque economy continues to develop and grow and it goes above 6.24% in GDP, they will still be held to that 6.24, and they'll be able to say to Spain, well, when it was below, we didn't, you know, quibble about reducing the quota, we're not going to quibble about it now. So I think it's about having that kind of taking that judgment. I mean, it has to be said that the left nationalists, who represent 21 of the 75 MPs in the Basque Parliament, as opposed to the what you may call the mainstream nationalists, the PNV have got 27. They do want to renegotiate it, because they said that it shouldn't be spent on things they don't agree with, like the monarchy, Spanish monarchy, defence, etc. But the rest of the parties basically take the view that it's really up to Spain to decide how it spends its money, just as it's up to the Basque Country to decide how it spends its money. And so they have a non kind of interference kind of policy. And I just, you know, is there anything else anybody wants to ask about it? Jim's just pointed out here, of course, that because it has to be agreed unanimously as well, it makes it difficult to change, but there is no real urge to change it at this point, broadly across the Basque Country. Mark?
Can I ask him here, perhaps from a slightly different angle, but one of the issues that obviously we've been looking at both with this committee and also with the Devolution and Further Powers Committee is around the scrutiny that can be applied to intergovernmental relations, intergovernmental agreements, particularly around the fiscal framework. And I just wondered, I note here there's an arbitration process is mentioned, but I wondered what scrutiny, if any, is applied to the discussions and negotiations that take place between the Basque government and the Spanish government, particularly in relation to financial operations and the economic agreement.
But my understanding is the scrutiny is quite in depth, because not only the arbitration board, you've got the when they have discussions, the two sides are represented by six individuals each, and the Basque Country is represented by three representatives from the Basque Parliament, and also one from each of the regional provinces. So there is quite each of them obviously wants to look at how it's impacting on themselves. So I think there is quite extensive scrutiny, because it is a key aspect of their entire financial structure. So I do think they do scrutinise it quite effectively. Richard?
I think the key point that Mark brings up there, though, is that whatever structure we come up with needs to be very open to parliamentary scrutiny. I think Kenny's right. Obviously, there's great representation in terms of the municipalities and as well as the Basque government. I didn't get a strong sense of what the parliamentary scrutiny was. You know, so what I think certainly for us, learning process is a structure there, but I think we'd have to, you know, just as you know, we've got a different parliamentary structure here, and so I think we'd have to, you know, attach that and what, you know, the you know, obviously when we want to establish best practice in that, in terms of the scrutiny of the way the process works, but I think the learning process for me is in the fact it's got to be a bilateral approach, and having that for me the joint committee and the fact that it's there, that's a big thing to take from it. I think we'll have to develop our own process of scrutiny, to be honest.
To be fair, we were looking a lot at what the relationship between the Spanish state was and the Basque Country in terms of the transparency between how those two institutions actually operate. How the Basques then feed it back to their own provincial governments and parliament, we didn't really pay as much attention to. But one imagines that they actually do scrutinise that. I mean, I would have thought that the Basque Parliament would want to know exactly what its representatives were doing in terms of representing it in Madrid in terms of this agreement, and making sure that you know, everybody was playing by the rules. But there certainly seems to be, though, the broad consensus that it has been beneficial for both sides. And we've seen in Scotland, obviously, we're in the third Scotland bill in less than two decades, whereas there has, seems to have been a level of stability in the Basque Country, which has allowed that those areas to develop significantly over the years. Jean?
Well, it's kind of only related in thoughts, but, I mean, you know, this committee has made some efforts to go and look, both in, well, in Stockholm and now in the Basque Country and at a visit to Ireland. But, I mean, has there been any interest in from the Westminster government in looking at, before they declared this the most devolved region in the world, quote unquote, that they've spent any time looking at how the Basque region works within Spain or any other devolved region in order to draw that conclusion?
Speak really for the Westminster government, no, and I don't think I would necessarily agree that it's the most devolved place on earth. I don't think, well, I don't think, frankly, that is the case at all. I mean, there clearly seems to be greater devolution here. I mean, you can see in the report a whole list of taxes which are administered by the Spanish state, but they're all kind of collected as well in the Basque Country, and we're talking about everything from VAT, excise duties, income taxes, corporation taxes. Corporation taxes are different, incidentally, in the Basque Country. They also have a wealth tax. So there are a lot of taxes that are different. So it's certainly there seems to me more devolution. And what's been seen is that it's been seen to be able to operate with a high level of stability over a long period of time.
Thank you.
Anything else? Okay. Well, thank you very much for that. We'll put that into the record. And thank you very much, everyone, for your contributions today.